everyone. I'm Midge Johnson. I'm one of the artists in the show here today. And before I start, I just want to emphasize that this is being live streamed and the camera is right on that post. So if you could please refrain from standing up. We also may have people standing in the back and they won't be able to see if you stand up. So just be mindful of that, please. So welcome. I am really honored to be participating in this artist talk here at the fabulous Mara Gallery. Before I start, also I want to thank Mara and her wonderful gallery for this opportunity. This is closing night of the fabulous exhibit that she put on. I'm also very excited to talk to you about the history of abstract expressionism art and music, along with my husband, Alan Wasserman, who is a fabulous classical pianist who's performed all around the world, and he's also a teacher of teachers, and you'll get to meet him in just a bit. Our presentation today will follow a format of Alan speaking about music of the time and playing a piece, and then I will follow with a discussion on a particular artist of a particular art period. So we're going to explore the question, how do we get from the painting on the left, a realistic painting by Pissarro, painted in 1862, to this abstract expressionist painting on the right, painted by me in 2021. That's a time period of well over 100 years. So we're going to take that journey, but don't worry, it's not going to take me that long to get there. So please keep in mind, as we take this journey through the time, the musical and art movements, that movements are fluid. There's not an actual stop and start point, because they happen in different countries at different times, and they branch out, and it takes time for a movement to solidify. So we may seem a little bit jumping around, but really we're following a very broad path toward abstract expressionism, which we'll get to. But I'd like to set the mood to talk about Impressionism. Alan, can you play something for us and tell us about Impressionism?
So I'm going to take a turn, and I think, can you hear me loudly enough if I'm over here, right? I think, and I get to make the cell phone announcement, which is if you have some type of electronics with you that has some type of tiny beep, now would be a good time to stifle that and to mute that, please. Thank you for that, and I want to point out that I find it really interesting, as we were working on this project, how often it is that new styles, new modes that come in seem so shocking at the time and so groundbreaking when they happen, right? But really, when you look back at them through a historical perspective, it's funny how logical it is, or how sensible that next movement really was. Even though at the time you're going, oh my God, Debussy, it's so wild. But when you look back, you see it's quite a logical outgrowth of Chopin and Franz Liszt and the music that came right before it. So we'll be speaking about that a lot today. I want to move us now to Paris, France, at the end of the 1800s now, where the music of Claude Debussy is happening. Debussy is known as the father of Impressionist music. And a big change from the past that Debussy's doing is that he's using a lot of this extended sound we call 9th, 11th, and 13th chords. These extended kind of chords, instead of just that C major chord, he's using these kind of sounds. And instead of this, he'll use this, right, and Chopin uses it a lot to immediately resolve, but we'll see that Debussy is listening to these and starts using them, and they become extensively used here. They become more the normal instead of happening once in a while. Later today, we're going to speak about these concepts growing and growing as we move into modern jazz movements and the like. So I'll be speaking about Bill Evans, and we'll cover that more. So now, to the end of the 1800s, this is the great Claude Debussy. It's his piece called The First Arabesque. He wrote two of them, and this is The First Arabesque.
Thank you, Alan. That was beautiful.
Thanks.
Very dreamy. A great way to set up to talk about Impressionism, Claude Monet. Claude Monet is widely thought of as the founder of Impressionism. It's funny that an art critic called this particular painting, which is titled Impression Sunrise, that Monet painted in 1872, the critic called it impression painting, and he intended that as an insult. And the term caught on, and I guess has lasted a very long time. So the Impressionists left the goal of painting realistically behind, and they wanted to express their impression of a subject. They still had a subject, but they didn't want to have to portray it literally. As you know, Monet is famous for his water lily paintings. This is one of his first water lily paintings, Nymphia, and it's got a dreamy, hazy feeling of the Impressionist period. He started painting his water lilies around 1897. This is the first painting. And you can see, we can tell that these are water lilies, but they appear more suggested than literal. And they also have a very dreamy, cloudy feeling to them. Here is a much later water lily painting by Claude Monet. And this becomes even more impressionistic. As he's painting and painting, he's really leaning toward impression. In this one, the water lilies barely have any form, and this painting is completely dreamy and filled with color and feeling. I happen to love that one. So we're solidly into Impressionism at this point in painting, when he painted this. Now, we artists often work in a series. We pick something and we do it over and over and over again in different ways. Well, did you know that Monet painted over 250 water lily paintings in his lifetime? I think that we can say he definitely painted in a series. One, a friendly critic of Monet's work, expresses Monet's work as more about the doing than the seeing. And we're going to emphasize this as we go on with other artists, the gesture and the seeing, rather than the seeing. But first, Alan, would you let us know what's happening with music?
All right. So, meanwhile, over in America, music has this happy voice that's ringing out. And this next piece is by the great Scott Joplin, the composer of the ragtime style. As a piano teacher, I like to point out that actually Joplin was making music that many people were making at the time. But Joplin's parents made him take piano lessons, and he learned how to write his music down. And so 100 years later, here we are celebrating his music still, this great music by Scott Joplin. This piece is called The Cakewalk, and a cakewalk is a way to describe how you would walk home from the bar at 2 or 3 in the morning, where you're sort of going a little this way and a little that way. But in general, you're going forward, is the important thing here. I like to point out that there's also a sense of pride in this kind of cakewalk, in this kind of walk as well. This piece was one of Scott Joplin's favorites, so I like to go there. This one was composed in 1917, this brings us to 1917. Scott Joplin, his pineapple rag, purposely two words. So it's the pineapple rag.
Yeah,
he's longing for the apple. Is that mining? Is he longing for the apple?
Don't dare to comment on that.
Thank you.
around the same time as Monet was painting water lilies in the Impressionist style, Vincent van Gogh also painted in the Impressionist style. And Van Gogh's life overlaps with Claude Monet and also with Debussy, the music that we heard as the first piece. This particular painting, however, the Potato Eaters, painted in 1885, is fairly realistic. But soon, Van Gogh's work is going to change into a much more impressionistic style. Here is his masterpiece, The Starry Night, painted in 1889. That's only 4 years after the painting that we just saw, so radically different. Notice the boldly colored brush strokes in the sky that are just charged with movement and energy, and they just give us the impression of the stars in the sky at night. Now, I cannot speak of Van Gogh without thinking about sunflowers, because they're my favorite flower. So here's one of his many sunflower paintings. This one was painted in 1889. I happen to love the asymmetrical vase and also the interesting angle of the stem on the right side of the vase with flower painting down. So we are going to also see sunflowers a few other times because they're my favorite flower, but for now, maybe Alan can tell us what's going on in music.
So we're moving. Yes, so we're going to move now forward in America to the great George Gershwin, who lived from 1898 until 1937. A composer who ran on the border of classical and jazz. He really is so famous as a jazz name, of course, but he really wanted to be a classical musician, so much so that he goes all the way to Paris, France, to study with the great Nadia Boulanger, as Aaron Copland had done, and many other Americans had done. He gets there, and Madame Boulanger says to him, "No, no, I refuse to teach you. You're better off being the great George Gershwin than some two-bit classical composer." So he writes American in Paris while he's there. As you know, he's very famous for his Broadway music. He comes back to New York. He loves composing, though, still in this classical style, even though really he's sort of becoming part of Tin Can Alley and that big music scene in New York City based around the Brill Building, for people who know their New York City buildings. This is an example of, and so I want to say that though he's doing all that, he's still writing like Rhapsody in Blue for orchestra and these great orchestral pieces. I want to play for you a piece that is also from this classical genre, though you'll see it's so jazz infused it's hard to tell if you would call this classical or not. This is his Prelude number 1. He wrote 3 preludes that he published in 1926, and here's Prelude number 1. Is the volume of the piano okay there? Here we go.
Nice meeting you. Thank you.
So, as we move on from Impressionism to abstract art, it's going to get crazy because we're going to begin with Pablo Picasso, a Spanish artist. He lived from 1881 to 1973. Alan loves to talk about Beethoven having brought us not through one musical movement, but through two musical movements in his lifetime, which is just incredible. But Picasso actually does the same thing, if not three. He takes us from realism to cubism, then he changes cubism from analytical cubism to synthetic cubism, and then he takes us to fauvism and even what we call today mixed media, which is using other elements in your work other than paint. And in his case, he began to use a lot of collage in his work. Starting with La Demoiselle, excuse my French, painted in 1907, we see an example of early cubism, or analytical cubism as it later was known. It has geometric shapes forming the subject. Again, there's still a subject, but it appears flat, almost monochromatic. Cubists tear down the subject and they look at it from several perspectives at the same time. And that's why sometimes when we look at those paintings, we can feel a little bit wonky because our brain doesn't expect us to see things from two different perspectives at the same time. Picasso and others then explore cubism further and they change it to what we now call synthetic cubism, shown in this painting, Three Musicians, which was painted in 1921. It uses shapes that still appear flat, but it has more color, and the shapes feel like they're layered on top of one another. Here's a look at those two paintings side by side, painted 14 years apart. And Picasso was just keeping on evolving. Now, we cannot talk about Picasso without talking about one of his most famous paintings, Guernica, which he painted in 1937. It's enormous in scale, and it depicts the carnage of the Spanish Civil War. Well, let's look back from where we started. On the left, we have a painting, Massacre at Chios, painted by Delacroix in 1824. Chios is in Greece, and this painting is expressing the carnage of war after it was invaded by the Turks. Obviously, it's painted in a realistic style. And then on the right, we have Picasso's Guernica, painted in 1937 in an abstract cubist style. Same intention, expressed artistically in two very different ways. So we will next move out of abstraction and get into abstract expressionism, where art and music become much more modern. So I'd like to know what Alan can tell us about modern music.
Okay, excellent. And so I'd like to speak now on a very sensitive subject, the music of Alan Wasserman, because the next piece is one that I've composed myself. I've studied, many know me as someone who studied piano technique over 30 years of private lessons, of weekly lessons, and workshops, and all sorts of things, but a lot of people don't know, I also spent 12 years having two teachers at the same time, studying theory and composition, because I really intend, I love the discipline of composition intensely. So I want to share with you a piece I wrote in 1985, but it's written as an homage to the great Arnold Schoenberg. And Arnold Schoenberg is working in the early 1920s, mid-1920s, and this theory, these theories of his carry forward into the 1930s, 40s, even 50s, because Schoenberg is a very influential teacher, and he's teaching a lot of major composers who take his theories and expound upon them as well. So he is, and the thinking here is that if we're going to keep opening up harmony and opening up sound extensions, as I mentioned in the Debussy, why not go for having every note be equally important? So instead of having a major kind of sound or a minor kind of sound, let's just create a whole new environment for sound. So he takes the 12 possible notes. You know, there's C, C sharp, D, D sharp, E, et cetera. And there's 12 of them. So he takes them and he places them in order in what we call a tone row. And purposely creating this tone row to avoid major or minor, to avoid tonality. And the tone row you're going to hear now for my piece goes... these are the 12 notes in order that you'll be hearing. There are some strict rules for this piece, however. Let's see, so I should say quickly that it's not quite that simple. He takes the 12 tones and then you can run them backwards, and that's called a retrograde. And then you could run it upside down, meaning if you went up a whole step, you could go down a whole step. That's called a inversion when you do that. Well, you could then run that backwards, you have the retrograde inversion. Then you can put it in starting on any one of the 12 notes. So they make this giant chart called a golden cube that you then start to compose from. Well, I've composed a totally different type of aleatoric piece here. We were speaking earlier, a couple of people around, whoops, my postcard. Thank you, Lisa. That in modern music, composers are starting to use all these weird ways of writing music, and it's starting to open up how you might want to write music. And so I've composed this piece, and this is only a partial piece for Steve, that it's a large circle, and my tone row is around the entire circle. Then each of those tone rows has a circle around it, and I'm only playing the first movement, so I've left this blank today. But there would be more of these around if we were doing a 30 or 40 minute piece. But in order to do a 2 minute piece, I'm just doing this. This is a type of called graphic notation. It's made so purposely your piece is different every time. And this piece does have a lot of rules, actually, even though it's so shockingly free. One rule is, particularly in this piece, it's a very strict tone row. You must go from one note to the next to the next. Some composers let you go back and forward and back and forward. This is only going forward. But there's a lot of freedom here because the player is free to play the notes for any duration you want. You can hold it as long as you like. You may play it in any octave you wish. You could repeat a note as often as you like. You can play on any instrument you like, as long as you're playing these notes. And there can be as many players as you like. So today I'm playing a solo, but this has normally been done in, and I've performed, we've had this piece performed many times, I'm happy to say, mostly with a small chamber group, you would say. So, So I want to say this is a modern classical composition. It takes us into what we sometimes call the avant-garde. And as many of you know here, I'm sure, as they say, life is hard in the avant-garde. and especially as compared to popular music and the like. So, if you would please just quiet your mind, settle down, quiet your thoughts, and just ride the waves of the music. Don't expect to find a certain beat. It doesn't work that way. Just let these sounds wash over you. This is called Cyclical World.
Thank you.
designer was needed, just let every young be its own. Rules are kind of falling away, but yet there's still structure and a lot of.
It's like there's new rules. As the comedian said, right? New rules.
So now we are going to talk about, and we've arrived at, abstract expressionism. Yay, that's my favorite form of art. I hate that style. Right after World War II, a strong art movement took hold in the United States, specifically in New York City and then later other places. And this is when art changed radically again. Another movement is here. And we're moving from abstraction to abstract expressionism. So what is abstract expressionist art? Well, it relies on the artist's freedom to express emotion. They no longer feel they need an identifiable subject. Now, there are many forms of abstract expressionism. There's figurative, abstract, drip paint, mixed media, color field, zippers, I mean, you name it. But they all have the common goal of expressing pure emotion or pure ideas. The irascibles. There are 17 abstract expressionists in this group, in the photograph in that group, including Jackson Pollock. Note there's only one woman in that group. Her name is Hedda Stern. She's the tall person in the back. They're called the irascibles because the Metropolitan Museum of Art was putting on an exhibition of modern art, but it was not including abstract expressionism. So they protested and they boycotted the show, and it got them a lot of publicity, which really helped them in their movement, as you can see from the newspaper article there. Jackson Pollock, very well known for introducing an entirely new way of painting. He would drip paint, throw it on a large canvas on the floor. The term action painting was coined to describe his method, because the paint went according to his body movements. And we talked about gesture before. So it's also sometimes called gesture painting. This drip painting may look haphazard. It actually looks different on this screen than it looks on my screen. I still like it very much. But the way that Pollock concentrated the drips, the way he selected and paired and layered the colors, the choice of dense areas versus less dense areas, all of this required great artistic sensibilities and training, and perhaps more planning than we might imagine. So when I hear the phrase, my five-year-old could have painted that, I say, no, that's not so. There's a lot that goes into it. And besides, these giant paintings wouldn't fit on grandma's refrigerator So Alan, we've really entered modern times. What about the music of the time?
Yes, so let's speak about the jazz era that's really coming into vogue now, that artists like Jackson Pollock so love, and several of the artists that we're about to speak of as well. This is a piece by Dave Brubeck that I want to play now. It's a very cool example of rhythm-oriented music that's really a lot of fun. This song counts to 9. And songs that are in 9, you know, usually a song is in 4, or we'll say it's a waltz because it's in 3, right? So here I'm going to be counting to 9 in this piece. And you can break up 9 many different ways. So the main way he breaks this up is in 3 groups of 2 and then a group of 3. So you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And a little faster, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Then, every fourth line, he breaks it into 3 groups of 3. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. This came about when he had gone to Turkey, traveled to Turkey, and the musicians there were used to doing these weird kinds of rhythms. And he said to them, well, can we just play the blues? And the Turkish musician said, well, this is the blues. So, here we go. Good luck keeping up with this fast counting then. This is the blue rondo a la Turkey. Thank you.
that's the kind of music that the Abstract Expressionists in New York were listening to at the time. Beautiful, huh? So far we've been discussing all male artists, and this exhibit, which is closing today, happens to feature female artists. So let's take a look on some of the groundbreaking women who were Abstract Expressionists. We start with Lee Krasner. She was a New York City Abstract Expressionist artist, and this is her untitled work in 1940, which at this point in her life is the Cubist style. In 1942, she meets Jackson Pollock at a gallery where they both were exhibiting work. One thing leads to another. They got married in 1945, they moved to the suburbs, they both continued to paint and exhibit. During the time she was married to Pollock, she painted her series called Little Things, two of which are shown here. At this point, she has clearly entered the abstract expressionist style of painting. After his death in 1956, she begins to paint larger, and her work becomes much more infused with color. Here's a work on paper done in 1964. It's colorful, done with felt pen, pastel, and acrylic on paper. And here is a large painting she also did in 1964 entitled Icarus. It's large, it's bold, it's brilliantly colored. So, Alan, what was happening in music now?
All right. So, I need my paper here. Let's see, then. I want to show you a piece now by a composer named Steve Reich. And this represents a move. We were already talking about moving away from harmony and moving away from traditional timbre, and now we're even going to move away from traditional instruments. And we started to say, if all tones are considered equal, why not have all sounds be considered equal? And in fact, even hand clapping. And so here's a piece based on a 12-beat rhythm that repeats again and again and again and again and again and again. We have an exceptional person with us today as a guest artist and a performer tonight here on her hand clapping debut. So if you would give her a big hand. Lisa Craven is an artist as well, a visual and musical artist, and in fact a recipient of the Halo Arts Award this year. Yes? And please ask her more about that after the program here, because it's great what she's doing. I saw her practicing her drums on Facebook and with her dog complaining about the noise that was going on, and I knew that Lisa would be the perfect, as a founding member of the Mara Studio Gallery Hand Clapping Society, that will start here tonight. Lisa will be playing an ostinato pattern that keeps on going, that means a repeating pattern over and over, while I play the moving pattern of this duet. This is a good luck to you situation, and every time we do this, this was composed in 1972. And this is, again, Steve Reich. Shall we use this music stand, Lisa, right? I guess we're okay, we have a microphone right here.
Well, we're fine. Everybody's
clapping on here. Except Mitch has all that. Get that out of there. Was there more to say? That was everything, really. Just take your luck.
Yes.
Are you okay with this score?
Did you show
I was just on the. Yeah. Well, should I say this has a. This is an interesting aleatoric score, also, pardon me, that just has one row of music. And there's 12 notes or rests going across the page. And from there, you derive all the other parts. And you derive the other parts by moving over one beat 12 times, and so there's 13 parts. And so we've wound up, here's numbers 7 through 13, there's 1 through 6, and you play them as many times as you want. So we'll be repeating one a number of times, and then you go to number 2, and then maybe do that 3 times or 6 times, depending on how much patience the audience has. Depending on the amount of tomatoes. You're going to love this.
We expect reciprocal fire.
All right, so Steve Wright, clapping music.
Artists. And she broke into that group of irascibles that we saw the photograph of earlier. And she was at least 20 years younger than most of them. But they accepted her because of her talent, and she was on equal footing with them. This is an early work of hers, Mountains and Sea, painted in 1952. She painted differently than the rest. She thinned the oil paint down with turpentine, and she let it slide onto the surface of an unprimed canvas. Most of us paint on primed canvas because we don't want the paint sinking through the fibers of the canvas, but she wanted that. So it did sink into the fibers, and it almost appears like a watercolor wash, resulting in a look that's very gentle and flat and merged with the canvas. This is, here we have a work, Sudden Snow, painted in 1987. She's still using that staining technique, but here we see more texture and marks in the painting, and she leaves open space for us to have it appear lighter and more inviting. Now we get to Joan Mitchell. I love this one. Painted in 1957, she was one of the Ninth Street women. I especially love this, not just for the painting and the beautiful brush strokes, but for the title. It's titled, George Went Swimming in the Park at Barnes Hole, but it got too cold. I just love that. I also love the style of the, and the energy of her work. Oh, by the way, George was her dog. Here is another Joan Mitchell painting, City Landscape, painted in 1955, very large, 80 by 80. She's moved into a period where she's working in enormous sizes. And I promised you sunflowers. Here we see Sunflower, painted in 1972. 20 years after the early ones I showed you. Now we go to Elaine de Kooning. She was married to Willem de Kooning. He was one of those irascibles in the photograph article. This is painted in 1970. Notice how Elaine never really abandons subject the way the others did, but yet this is very different. For example, look at this Abstract Expressionist piece that she painted in 1963. We cannot identify a subject here, really. Well, actually, this is not the full painting. I altered it. This is the full painting.
Oh, oh, wow.
It's a portrait of John F. Kennedy that she was commissioned to do.
It looks like
I simply took his head and feet away, and when you do that, as you saw, you really cannot tell that it's a portrait. But she was a very well-known portrait artist in this style. Music yet?
Music.
I got out of order with that.
Yes, that's it. Now it's the jazz
piece. Okay. I was a little out of the reverse.
That handsome guy on the slide earlier would be on now.
Just imagine him, if you will.
So I want to play you a fun piece that's from 1946. This is right after World War II. This makes fun of the classical composer Rimsky-Korsakov, the great Russian composer who composed Flight of the Bumblebee. This is a shockingly American version, which we call the Bumble Boobie. This is Jack Fina, 1946.
Thank you.
So I'm going to talk about Pat Pasloff and Milton Resnick. They're husband and wife team of abstract, and they are abstract expressionists. At the same time, the movement in New York City. But they were married, but they had separate studios in buildings in the Soho area. And they were sort of behind each other, and they could look across the fire escape at each other. So I guess the secret to a good marriage is to keep the work separated.
Have a separate building.
Do you hear that? So on the left here, we have Milton Resnick's painting, Continent. He painted this in 1963. He painted very, very large, and he put countless layers of paint on it, giving lots and lots of texture. I read that he used so much paint that sometimes his canvases weighed up to 300 pounds. Oh, wow. I can't even imagine. I have seen his really large work, but I just can't.
We never had to lift it.
We didn't. Pat's painting, Stove, on the right, was painted in 1959. She uses thick paint and bright color. That X that she placed in the upper right corner is very daring in art, but I think that it works in this painting. As painters, we often strive for movement in our work. It's a flat canvas, but we want things to move. Most of us. I certainly do. So I love this quote of Pat Pasloff's. A painting must be still as a breath held at the apex of a leaf. And I put the ballerina there to show you it's just, it's moving, but the stillness is just that second. So let's hear from Alan about music of this tune.
Okay. So again, moving into a modern jazz realm, I want to say how, what a beautiful photograph. I want to say that for this piece, this is by the great pianist and composer named Bill Evans. Bill Evans was so great that he became Miles Davis's pianist, as well as Chet Baker's pianist as well, and then left them because he wanted to be exploring music in his own direction. Music takes the harmonic elements that we spoke of with Debussy and then again with Schoenberg, and it takes it even further. The music of Bill Evans is known to have these splashes of color, these very bold chords with the right time using these unusual chords. So instead of a normal C7 I would have played, he uses a C7 flat 5 flat 9 just for fun. And instead of the C7, he'll use a C7 plus 11, C13 plus 11, is that chord, the H7 flat 9. And maybe most famous for this chord, the G flat major 7 plus 11. And that you'll be hearing in here as well. So this is a piece that Evans dedicated to his niece named Debbie, and this is a waltz for Debbie. Thank you.
notable transition from realistic art to abstract expressionism. And here are my sunflowers again, I promised you. Van Gogh's sunflower painted in 1890 in an impressionist style is on the left. In the middle, a painting by Steichen painted in an abstract style. And Joan Mitchell painting sunflower in an abstract expressionist style in 1972. So I would say we've come a long way, baby. So that's the end of our program, but I would like to really thank you all for being such a great audience. I would like to thank Lisa for helping with the program. I spent countless hours getting that rid of and that tiny and I want to thank Nara for all of the things she does for us.
Yeah, so we go. I'd like to end with a piece that brings us back to the beginning again, to the mid-1800s. This is an unusual composer named Louis Moreau Gottschalk, who's not well known enough. This piece is written in 1853, but it really precedes ragtime by a good 50 years. So he's quite an amazing composer. He was a touring pianist in the middle of the Civil War. Imagine that. He sadly dies at 40 years old from being overworked, essentially. This piece is very American. He lives at a time when it was thought only savages lived in the United States. And he embraced that and started to use American themes in his music, as you'll be hearing. And in fact, to even imitate the most American of instruments, this piece is titled for the banjo, Louis Moreau Gottschalk.
Thank you.
please.